Hello, and welcome to our in-depth look at communications with precision data converters. In the I2C protocol, writing to and reading from the target device requires the use of an I2C address. The I2C address identifies which device the controller wants to communicate with. Typically, this address is written over a single byte, where the address itself is 7 bits, and an additional bit is used to indicate a read from or write to the device. In other videos, we discuss the communication protocol and show how I2C addressing is done. However, not all addresses of the 7 bits can be used for target devices. In this video, we'll show that some addresses are reserved for other purposes and we'll show what functions these reserved addresses may be used for. I2C has several sets of reserved addresses that are limited for use based on specific applications. Again, the standard I2C address is a 7-bit word. Theoretically, that would imply that there are 128 7-bit addresses available for devices on the I2C bus. However, some of those 128 addresses are reserved. This table shows addresses that are reserved for I2C communications. The functions called with these reserved addresses are options for devices and are not necessarily available in all I2C devices. The first reserved address is I2C address 0 and is the general call address. A write from the general call address is used to address all the devices connected to the I2C bus at the same time. Not all devices are designed to respond to the general call address. However, if the device does respond, then it may process a second byte and the following bytes after the general call. If the LSB of the second byte is a 0, the second byte may be used to send commands to those devices receiving the general call. For example, one of the common commands sent through the general call is a reset. If the second byte is 06 in hexadecimal, the controller device sends a general call reset to all devices on the I2C bus. If the LSB of the second byte is a 1, the controller is sending a hardware general call. In this case, the controller device may be a hardware controller that may not be programmed to transmit to a particular target address, or it may not know what device it needs to send the command to. Instead, the second byte is used to send the controller's own address to identify itself to all the devices on the system. This address then can be recognized by another processor device in the system that can be used to direct information from the hardware controller. A read from I2C address 0 is the start byte. Not all microprocessors have a built-in onboard I2C controller, and it may not have an interrupt to detect communication on the bus. In that case, a microprocessor monitoring the I2C bus would need to repeatedly pull the SDA and SCL lines to ensure communications aren't missed. This requires the device to pull at a fast rate to detect the I2C address. One option would be to use a start byte before the communication. When the controller uses the start byte with 7 zeros in the address, the target device can pull at a much slower rate, saving processing power. After the target device detects that the SDA has sent a 0 during the start byte, it can then switch to faster pulling to detect the next I2C transmission for the address being sent. Once the I2C transfer has ended with a stop condition, the target device can then resume pulling at a slower rate, again saving processing power. The next three I2C addresses listed in the table are all reserved for different reasons. Address 01 is reserved for the CBUS protocol so that CBUS devices could be placed on the I2C bus. However, the CBUS protocol is no longer used, and this I2C address is ignored by most devices. Address 02 is reserved for different bus formats. This is designed to allow communication between different protocols. Only I2C devices that work between different protocols can respond to this address. Address 03 is reserved for future purposes. The next reserved addresses are for the high-speed controller code. These codes are from 04 to 07. The 8th bit normally used for read-write indication is used as part of the high-speed controller code. These high-speed controller codes are reserved 8-bit codes, which are not used for target addressing or other purposes. Each high-speed controller has its own unique controller code, and this allows for up to 8 high-speed controllers on the I2C bus. The controller code for a high-speed mode controller device is software programmable and is chosen by the system designer. Devices that support high-speed mode start operation in standard or fast mode. The controller code enables high-speed mode. The high-speed controller code allows for arbitration between the high-speed controllers, and it indicates the start of a high-speed mode transfer. It enables internal current sources, allowing the I2C communication bus to be faster than with just pull-up resistors. When enabled, high-speed data transfer continues through the data transmission. A repeated start continues high-speed mode data transmission, while a stop condition returns the I2C bus to fast or standard mode. This diagram shows the beginning of a high-speed mode transmission. Here, we'll show how a controller writes the high-speed controller code to the device. First, the device starts in standard or fast mode. The controller sends a start condition. Then the first byte is sent with the reserved address used for the high-speed controller code. Again, this isn't an address and it uses the full 8 bits for the controller code. Because this value sent is not an address, there is no response from the device and it is not acknowledged or NACked. However, the controller code enables high-speed mode for all devices that are capable of high-speed mode. Even though the controller code is NACked, the device internal circuits for high-speed mode are enabled. The controller then sends the target address of the high-speed mode device and follows with a read or write bit for communication. Data is transmitted by the controller or target with acknowledgement for each data byte, similar to the standard I2C communication. The target device continues communication until it receives a stop condition or it receives a repeated start for a new target address. Addresses 7C to 7F are all reserved for device ID. The controller starts by sending the reserved device ID address, followed by a write bit. The controller then sends the target device address that it wants to identify. The controller then sends a restart condition, followed by the reserved device ID address, followed by a read bit. The diagram shows the data format from the 3 bytes of device ID. This data starts with 12 bits for the manufacturer ID, followed by 9 bits for the part identification, completed by 3 bits for the die revision. Here, we'll show how a controller reads information with the device ID address. First, the controller sends a start condition. The first byte is sent with the reserved address for device ID and is followed by a 0 for a write. At this point, there may be multiple targets that may respond to device ID, so multiple devices may acknowledge this address. The controller then sends the address for the target device. The last bit of this target address byte is a don't care, followed by an acknowledge. There should be only one device here that acknowledges this address. The controller then sends a restart condition. After that, the controller sends the reserved device ID I2C bus address, followed by the read bit. The target device acknowledges this reserved address. Note that the beginning of this third byte must be a restart. A stop followed by a start condition, or a stop with a restart condition, followed by access to a different target device, resets the target device state machine and the device ID read cannot be performed. The target device then sends 3 bytes for device ID. The first byte gives the 8 MSBs of the 12-bit manufacturer ID. The controller then acknowledges the receipt of this byte. The target device then sends the second byte for device ID. The 4 MSB of the byte are the 4 LSB of the manufacturer ID. The 4 LSB of the byte are the 4 MSB of the part identification. The controller acknowledges the receipt of the second byte. The target device finally sends the third byte for device ID. The 5 MSB of this byte are the 5 LSB for the part identification. The 3 LSB of this byte are the 3 bits used for die revision. The controller NACs the last byte and concludes the device ID read with a stop. The reading of the device ID can be stopped at any time by sending a NAC. If the controller continues to acknowledge the bytes after the third byte, The target rolls back to the first byte and keeps sending the device ID sequence until a NAC has been detected. With the normal 7-bit I2C address and all of the reserved addresses, the number of possible I2C devices on a bus becomes limited. To expand the number of devices, several reserved addresses can be used to expand the address to 10 bits. In the reserved address, the last two bits of 7-8 hexadecimal to 7-B hexadecimal represent the first two bits used to expand the address space. A second full byte of 8 bits is used to complete the 10-bit address. Communication with the 10-bit address is very similar to the 7-bit address communication. Here, we'll show how a controller writes to a device with a 10-bit address. First, the controller sends a start condition. Then the first byte is sent with the reserved address for 10-bit I2C addressing and is followed by a 0 for a write. At this point, there may be multiple targets that have the same first address byte for 10-bit addressing, so multiple devices may acknowledge this address. Then the controller device sends the second byte of the target address. With the second byte, there should be only one device with the unique 10-bit address. This is the only device that should acknowledge the communication. With the 2 bits of the reserved address and the 8 bits of the second byte target address, this totals 10 bits of addressing. This target stays in communication with the controller until it receives a stop condition or the controller sends a repeated start condition to communicate with a different target address. Here, we'll show how a controller reads from a device with a 10-bit address. Reading from a 10-bit address device is similar but with added steps. First there is a start, followed by the reserved address, followed by a 0 for a write bit. This is followed by an acknowledge from all devices that use the reserved address. This is then followed by the target address second byte, and then an acknowledge from the addressed device. Until this point, the communication is exactly the same as a 10-bit address write. To read from this device, the controller then sends a repeated start. This is followed by the reserved address that was just used. Then the read bit is sent, followed by an acknowledge. Because the read bit is sent and not the write bit, the device that just acknowledged this communication understands that this is a read. Other devices with the same reserved address do not respond. The address device then acknowledges this repeat of the reserved target address. After the addressed device sends the acknowledge, data is transmitted by the device, and after each byte, the controller acknowledges the data. This data transmission continues until the controller sends a stop condition or a repeated start, followed by a different target address. That concludes this video. Thank you for watching. Please try the quiz to check your understanding of this video's content. Question 1. Which of the following does not use a I2C reserved address? The answer is B, device acknowledge. Question 2. How is I2C high-speed mode started? The correct answer is B, start by sending a high-speed mode controller code. Question 3. Which of the following is not identified by device ID data? The correct answer is A, device function.